I'm ready. Y'all ready to start worship today? Amen. You ready? Well, we're going to start today with believer's baptism, and I rejoice to any time we can have baptism. But we got two young men that gave their life to Christ some time ago. They've just been waiting. Do I got a heater in the baptistry? Boy, do we have a heater. Mercy. We go from one extreme to the other, ice cold or scalding hot, and it's pretty warm today. Well, people are still coming in. That's a good sign. Would you stand with me? Let's just honor the Lord and welcome His presence, the Holy Spirit. Go the Lord in prayer as we begin this day of worship and praise. Let's bow together. Father, we do come to you in the name of Jesus. And Holy Spirit, we welcome you into this hour of worship. My prayer today, Holy Spirit, you'd move in our service. Nothing would hinder the moving of the Holy Spirit. Speak to our hearts, save the lost, revive the saints. And thank you again, Lord, that we can begin this worship time today with believer's baptism. I thank you for these two precious ones that have given their heart and their lives to you. And Lord, we just thank you now that you are going to continue to do a mighty work in this place because we ask it in Jesus' name. And God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Mason, come on. It's warm.
Yay, I get warm.
All right, be quiet. Ready? Is Jesus living in your heart?
Yes.
Amen. Mason, because of your public profession of faith in Christ and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my little brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You bear with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. Bentley, look at him swimming to me. Come on. Boys. Bentley, does Jesus live in your heart?
Yes, sir.
Well, amen. Bentley, because of your public profession of faith in Christ and now in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my dear brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in newness of life. I think they're showing off for Grandma standing here. Well, let's worship now. Brother Kirk's going to come and lead us as we worship our Lord today.
Well, amen. That's a good way to start the service off.
Yeah. With us this morning. And if you're not a member of Milldale, please take a moment to fill the card out that is attached there to your worship guide and then bring it to me at the end of the service. I'll be in the foyer. I have a gift I'd love to give you before you leave out today. We got a couple things that we're wanting to do this morning, so you just bear with us. We're here to worship the Lord. We're here just to be obedient and do as the Lord would have us to do. One of the things that we're going to do today is we're going to have prayer, and then we're going to have a baby dedication. We have a little baby, precious child today that we want to dedicate to the Lord. So let's do that right now. Y'all bring Chevy here. Well, what a little Chevy. Y'all just be seated for just a moment, and then we're going to have a time of prayer. Brother Jason, our children's minister, I heard a moment ago, Pastor, we're going to give the youth, our children's minister a raise because he's dressed pitiful today, and I said the least he could have done is iron his dress, you know. But there's a reason for this, and you'll learn all about it this morning.
Okay, good morning. The reason I'm dressed like this is because we have VBS Commitment Sunday, and that is today. So I expect how many people are in here to sign up for VBS. Yeah, this is my famous excuse. I've done had my, served my time. You're still living. God hadn't called you home. You can serve. I got work. Hey, you can serve. It's called prayer. We have prayer requests every day, and we send it out to all our prayer warriors from the kids. And so everybody can at least pray, so everybody in this room can be a part of VBS. So that's why I'm standing here today, is to get you to sign up for VBS. At the end of the service, I do have on everybody's chair, VBS Marketplace. It talks about each area you can serve in VBS. And there is a little VBS table outside in the foyer. I will be there after church to answer any questions you may have about VBS this year. So now, baby dedication, my favorite time is when we're dedicating babies. Our theme verse for our children's ministry is Proverbs 22:6. Train up a child in the way that he should go, for when he is old, he will not depart from it. I went to a children's ministry conference a month ago, and it opened my eyes to why kids, the main reason why kids stray away from church after they are through college. First one, the influence of a marriage. The influence of a marriage. The family's marriage can keep a child away from church. So the way to keep them in church is for the parents to have a strong marriage. It's okay to fight. It's okay. The second one is serving. Parents are not serving in church. Kids see, they follow their parents' lead. And if they're serving in church, the kids will want to serve in church. 50% of kids whose parents served in church were more likely to stay in church than those who did not stay, who did not serve in church. 50%. So if parents, if you would give 7 years, it doesn't have to be just children or youth, just 7 years of each child's life in ministry, you'd make a huge impact on their lives alone. The influence of worship together as a family. There's a reason we worship together on the last Sunday of each month, because kids get to see their parents worship God, open their Bible, and read God's word. You are that influence. The influence of your discipline style. Don't just be so hardcore and don't be too loose. You know what's right for your child. The influence of the relationship with a pastor. Pastor. Brother Dennis is always with the kids, no matter where you look, with the school, the children's ministry, and that's a big influence. And the last one I'm going to give you is whether they have a high view of Scripture. This is the main thing from the parents. If their parents are in Scripture daily and they see that, they will have a high view of Scripture. And I'm not saying this is the fix, but it's the aid in keeping kids in church, and it's up to the family to do it. So today I ask that you, David and Blair, do you commit to the well-being of your kids this morning? Okay, would you like to pray?
Absolutely. Let me just say this morning that I've known Blair for a long time. Watched her grow up from a small child herself. And now today, my. Three children and another one on the way. God's been good and God has blessed this family. Let's pray a prayer of dedication today for Chevy. Would you bow with me as we pray? And as we pray in agreement, would you just lift your hands toward this family and this child as we pray God's blessings upon them? Father, I come today in the name of Jesus, and I thank you for this precious family. I pray your blessings upon them, and I pray now for little Chevy, Lord, that you'll bless this child. And I pray that these parents would train this child up in the way that he should go. And Lord, we believe your word that when he is old, he'll not depart from it. So again, I thank you for this time and for what this moment means. And Lord, this doesn't save this child, but our prayer is that the day will come when we will see Chevy walk this aisle and give his heart and his life to you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Blair, let me give Chevy his first little Bible. This is for him. This is your certificate of dedication. And I want you to put this in a safe place. And when this child one day gives his life to Christ, I want you to give this letter to him. I'm telling you, listen, this is just telling him that this day occurred and that we prayed for the very day that he'd give his life to Jesus. You know, I had a friend just recently baptized his daughter, and he put it all over Facebook, and he put that letter just reminding everybody of the day I dedicated my child to Christ, and today I have the privilege of baptizing my little daughter. So I believe in God because of the influence in this family, this home, that Chevy one day, just like these two, will pray to receive Jesus and follow him in believer's baptism. Amen. All right. God bless you. You can be seated. Now, I was asked if we would pray and anoint with oil, and we will certainly do that. I believe that it is scriptural. The Bible teaches if there's any among you sick, if they'll call for the elders of the church and they lay hands and pray and anoint with oil, the Bible says the prayer of faith, will raise the sick. Amen. So I want to honor the Lord today, and I want to honor the request of this family. So I'm going to ask Miss Sheila, Brother Monty, would you come stand here with your wife, Miss Sheila? Miss Sheila, can I share with why we're praying today? Miss Sheila had a colonoscopy this week and didn't get a real good report. But we're just going to believe God. We're just going to believe God. And God's going to touch her. And when they go back for further tests this week, you know, God might choose to use surgery. And that's okay. Mm-hmm. Thank God for the great doctors that we have today. But I also believe that when you go this week, after us praying today, that doctor can examine you and say, you know what? We can't find it anymore. Amen. It's gone. Amen. I want to ask the elders if you'd come first, all the men that pray with me, your elders, and come on. You men, come on. Come on. All you men, come on. Let's gather around her. She has asked this. Brother Monty has asked for this. And we're just going to be obedient. This oil, there's nothing magical about the oil. It just represents the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. And we believe that the Holy Spirit, God is still the divine healer. And we're believing today. Would you pray with me? Our Father, we come in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we're being obedient. Miss Sheila has asked that we pray and anoint. Brother Monty has asked today that we pray and anoint his wife. So Lord, we're just being obedient. And I'm asking you, Holy Spirit, dear Lamb of God, the great healer, the great physician, would you touch my sister right now? And I pray that this spot, this big area, this mass that's in her colon, I pray that it would begin even now to disappear. Touch her, Lord. I pray for healing. I pray for the healing power of God to touch Miss Sheila from the top of her head to the sole of her feet. Lord, all these years, Monty and Sheila have been faithful. They've served you. And I'm asking you in this time of need, bless and honor this dear family, how we love them, how we appreciate all they've done over the years. So God, now we're just believing every man at this altar, every person sitting in this congregation, God, today we believe. We believe in miracles because we believe in God. And so we're asking for that miracle on behalf of our sister. And now, Lord, we just want to thank you and praise you for hearing our prayer. We want to thank you and praise you, Lord, that healing is going to come. We're not telling you how to do it. We're not telling you what to do. We're just simply asking for your will to be done in Sheila's life. And we promise we'll give you all the praise. We'll give you all the glory for what you do. In Jesus' name. I said in Jesus' name. And everyone said amen and amen and amen and amen. Amen. It's going to be all right. It is. Tony is a member of our church, and he has an autoimmune disease that is attacking nearly everything in his body. I mean, I've watched this brother go down a lot in just recent weeks. Can't walk hardly anymore. And now it's starting to affect his voice. He can't even talk. Went to the doctor this week. Did not get a good report. So he's trusting God. And he wants to know if those same people can pray for me right now. Absolutely, I said, let's pray for him right now. We'll pray for you right here. Where's Lisa? Lisa, come on. This is his precious wife. It's been a dear, precious family to our church. Father, we come to you now in the name of Jesus, once again praying for our brother Tony. And Lord, this disease that is attacking his body and his spinal cord, I rebuke it in the name of Jesus. I pray, Father God, you touch my brother now from the top of his head to the sole of his feet. I pray that you'll return the strength to his feet and his legs, that he can once again walk and talk. And God, you can do for my brother what doctors in medicine cannot do.
That's it. Come on.
And I don't care what that doctor said this week.
Come on.
Yes.
You're still the one we're looking to.
Yes.
And we're believing right now that the healing power of God will touch my brother right now.
Yes.
And God, you'll begin to restore his mind, and every vital organ in his body will function the way you created it to function in the first place. For the spinal cord, I pray for everything would once again come together. And Father, there would be healing. I pray for Miss Lisa. I pray you'll give her strength and courage as she ministers to her husband. Now bless this family, Lord. They've been so precious, and they've been faithful ever since you sent them here. And Lord, we need them. There's so much to do and such little time to get it done in. So I'm asking again, as we prayed for Miss Sheila, God, let our brother Tony experience a miracle today, and we'll give you the praise and the glory for it in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. God bless you, brother. Yeah, we love you too. We love you too. Amen, brother. Keep doing it. You keep waking up with a smile. That's what makes Milldale special. All right. Let's just bow for prayer. Just bow with me. Lord, we just want to be obedient. We don't want to miss you. We've seen you move mightily already. God, just keep moving in this service. Have your own way. Be pleased with our worship today. Be pleased with our worship. In Jesus' name, let's worship. Spirit, come.
sing this out. I believe
in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection.
We love you. We thank you for all you've done.
Just praise Him. Whatever your situation is, praise Him. Some of you need to praise Him on faith. Father, we love you. Thank you. Just the voices. And how great is our God. Oh, sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Thank you.
God, sing with me how great is my God, and all will see how great, how great is our God. And then sings my soul, by this moment. I don't want to rush through your presence, because Father, this is what church is supposed to be. You getting rid of our schedule, because Father, it's about you. God, nothing we can conjure up can equal to the power of your presence. So Father, move. Father, thank you for what you're doing. Speak to your people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Take your Bibles and turn to Job chapter 1. Job, the first chapter. And I can assure you, when God gave me the message for today, I had no clue what this service would be like. But I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit's here. The children are going to children's church. I want to speak to you this morning on what to do when your world crumbles in. What to do when your world crumbles in. Our world today is full of pain and suffering and sorrow like I've never seen. From the cradle to the grave, things are going to happen that brings tears to our eyes. Now listen closely. Those tears can do one of two things. They can either obstruct my vision of heaven, or they can be really like a telescope and help me to see even greater things that God has in store for me. Amen. Now listen to me again. We are going to have times of tears, and we can do one of two things. We can either get better or become bitter. And I choose today to become better. Amen. Are y'all with me? Yes, sir. I read a book years ago, Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis. And in that book, he said, and I quote, "If I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world." Amen. End quote. Very few of us, if any, has ever had a week in our lives like Job. I started this series 2 weeks ago, so let me remind you of where we are thus far in our study. There was a conversation that took place in heaven between God and Satan. And it was God who brought up the idea to Satan, "Have you ever considered my servant Job? For there's none like him." And the devil's idea of Job was this: "Yes, I've considered him and I've saw him, but the only reason that Job serves you is because you're blessing him." And Satan's idea of Job was this: "If you will take away some of those blessings, I'll have Job cursing you to your face." Well, understand, my friend, God knew Job's heart. And so God said to Satan, "Okay, you can take the things that he has away, but you can't kill him." Let me tell you something. Again, this service today is guided by the Holy Spirit. I didn't know all this was going to happen today. Job had a rough week. But don't you miss the end of the story. Even though Job had a rough week, he never lost his faith in God. And even though he went through some horrible storms in his life, it did not shatter his faith. And so let me just jump to the end of the story and tell you something. In the end, Job didn't see it at the beginning, but in the end, when it was all said and done, God had restored more to Job in the end than he had at the beginning. What does that say to me? That says this: we serve a faithful God. Amen. Let's pick up the story this morning, beginning in verse 13 of chapter 1. Now watch what happens to Job. Verse 13 says, "There was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, and a messenger came to Job and said, 'The oxen were plowing and the donkeys feeding beside them. When the Sabines raided them, they took them away. Indeed, they have killed the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you.' And while he was still speaking, another came and said, 'The fire of God fell from heaven and burned up the sheep and the servants, and consumed them, and I alone have escaped to tell you.' And while he was still speaking, yet another came and said, 'The Chaldeans formed three bands, raided the camels, took them away, yes, and killed the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you.' And while he was speaking, another came and said, 'Your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house, and suddenly a great wind came from across the wilderness and struck the four corners of the house, and it fell on the young people, and they," watch this, "are dead, and I alone have escaped to tell you. So Job arose, tore his robe, and shaved his head, and fell to the ground and worshiped, and said, 'Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return there. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.' In all this, Job did not sin nor charge God with wrong." Wow. Life has a way of falling apart. Life has a way of crumbling down around us when we least expect it. Amen. Job, I believe, is a model. Job is the man I believe that God gives us to look at so that when those times come our way, we will know how to handle things and how to deal with the things that comes our way. There's something we can learn from this story in the book of Job on what to do when our world crumbles in. Let me ask you something. Now, I'm asking this, and I want a public display because I'm, listen to me, we're here today to help one another. Has there ever been a time in your life when your world caved in? Now, look around this room. I think everybody's raised their hand. We've all experienced it. And you know what? I love you, but here's the truth. You will continue to experience it. We're going to have those times, good times, tough times. We're going to have times when we're on the mountain, but we're going to have times in life when we're in the valley too. What do we do? How do we handle things when our world caves in around us? Here's the first thing you need to learn to do. Express your grief honestly. Express your grief honestly. Job expresses his agonizing grief, and he does it three ways. I want you to look at it, beginning in verse 20. It says, first of all, he tore his robe. Secondly, he shaved his head. And thirdly, the Bible says that he fell down on the ground to worship. Now, what does that mean? Well, first of all, the tearing of the clothes was just a customary way of expressing grief in those days. You've probably had grief in your life to the point that you would like to get your hands on something. Have you ever had grief in your life when you literally wanted to get something in your hands and tear it apart? You see, the tearing apart of the clothing, the cloth, was this. It expressed the grief. He pulled, he strained, he tore the cloth, and when it came in two, it was the relief of that pain. And then it says this. It says that Job, he shaved his head. The shaving of the head was the long-term expression of his grief. When he shaved his head, every time he could feel his bald head or the cool wind would sweep across the top of his head, he was reminded of his grief. When the hair began to grow back out on top of Job's head, it was a reminder that life goes on. Little by little, it growed out, and watch this, his full head of hair eventually returned. I'm telling you, there's going to be times when we experience grief and pain, but you listen to this, God's not forgotten you. He promised never to leave you, never to forsake you, and you might go through the valley, you might go through the hard times, you might go through the difficult times, there might be sickness, there might be pain, there may be heartache, but I'm telling you, in the end, it's going to be all right. Miss Sheila, I had this message planned before I knew. Tony, I had this message planned before I knew. Now, church, listen, when you're hurting, it's okay to express your grief. I said it's okay to express grief. Now, I believe it's more important to express your grief. I read this the other day. Listen to this. Because grief that is submerged or suppressed can lead to unhealthy emotional problems. In other words, there comes a point you got to let it out. I read this other day, and I believe I have this on your outline, an equation for grief. And it can be expressed like this. Here it is. It's on your outline. Change plus loss equals grief. Change plus loss equals grief. I think we'd all agree change is never easy. Amen. And sometimes we have things in life that are minor, but it still hurts, even minor things. But there are going to be times in life when we're faced with some major things, when we lose something or we lose someone that is precious and dear to us, and it creates grief in our hearts and in our lives. Man, Job's life was changed in one day. In a 24-hour period, he experienced material loss, and then he suffered personal loss. Wow, he lost all of his wealth in one day. Could you imagine waking up tomorrow, and before noon tomorrow, you discover you're broke. You have absolutely nothing. I mean, zero. That's what Job experienced. I checked the current cost of livestock today. Job's livestock in his day, if we compared it today, his livestock would have been valued at around $46 million. $46 million. Now, remember this. I base this on what the scripture says. Job had 7,000 camels. I asked Miss Jane on a text message, what does a camel sell for in the Middle East today? I like to pass out. $15,000 for a camel. I said, wow. She said, hold on. He gets more water per gallon than y'all get gas per gallon. Can you imagine? What happened to Job would be like you tomorrow. You lose your job. You lose your bank account. You lose your investments. You lose your retirement. I mean, everything in just a matter of hours, it's gone. Wow. No sooner did Job get that message, he found something else out. Worse than losing $46 million, he had three daughters and seven sons, and they were gathered in the eldest brother's home when a tornado came through and the house collapsed on top of those 10 children, and all 10 of his children were killed instantaneously. Wow, think about that for just a moment. He just found out that $46 million is gone. He's standing there thinking, man, what in the world am I going to do now? When the next servant knocked on the door and said, Job, a tornado came through. It collapsed the house and all 10, not 9, not 8, not 5, all 10 of your children are dead. Wow. I'm just trying to put myself in Job's shoes for just a moment. What if tomorrow, before noon, I lose all my income, all my investments, I lose everything, and while I'm pouting over losing my money, then I get the message that all four of my children were dead. Here's the thing the Holy Spirit reminded me. I don't want to be in Job's shoes, first of all. But here's what the Lord showed me and reminded me. Even with all that tragedy, Job did not deny his grief. I said, Job did not deny his grief. He didn't put on a fake smile and still tried to act happy and say, well, I've just lost $46 million and all 10 of my children were killed. Well, that's just the way it is. No, that's not Job's attitude at all. You know what the Bible says Job did? Listen to this. He's human like you and me. He cried. And the Bible says he cried long and hard to the point that his face was red. The Bible says in Job 16, verse 15 and 16, Job said, I have sewed sackcloth over my skin. I have buried my brow in the dust. My face is red with weeping. Deep, dark circles surround my eyes. Job was grieving. When you lose something, you grieve. And the greater the loss, the greater the grieving. Would you agree? I said the greater the loss, the greater the grieving. I've been told, I've seen this more times than I care to even think about it as a pastor, but I've been told one of the toughest things to experience in life is the loss of a child. I can't tell you how many times over the years I've had parents look at me and weep and say, Preacher, something's not right. My children are supposed to bury me. I'm not supposed to bury my child. Anybody here ever lost a child? Raise your hand. I want to see it. Mercy. Mercy. I can't imagine. But death. Death's not the only thing that causes grief. Here's things I've seen since I've been a pastor. When you lose a job, you grieve. When you lose a mate, either by death or divorce, you grieve. When you lose a friend, you grieve. I've been with church members. I've stood in their front yards and I've watched their homes burn to the ground. And we stood there and wept. I've seen many, and I keep hearing this, even recently, people are still grieving because our house flooded. We took on water and we lost everything. There's different things that causes us to grieve. You see, listen, and listen, I want you to hear this. I want you to get this. Whatever the nature of your loss is, it's so important to express your grief honestly. It doesn't show a lack of faith to cry a river of tears. The Bible even says that we as Christians sorrow, but we don't sorrow like the world does because we have hope. You see, even in the midst of our pain, in the midst of our loss, we can still have hope. If you go to the doctor tomorrow and the doctor gives you bad news, listen to me and hear me well. Even if you receive bad news before the day is over with, because of who lives in us, we still have hope. We still have something to hold on to. Amen. Jesus, the Bible says, was a man who was acquainted with sorrows and grief. Remember how he wept one day with Mary and Martha over the loss of Lazarus? Here's the thing, now the Lord reminded me of this. On the way to the grave site, Jesus already knew in his heart he's fixing to raise Lazarus. He knew it. But when he got there, Mary and Martha standing there and they're weeping. Oh, Lord, if you'd have just been a little earlier. So Mary and Martha were standing there, and they were just honestly expressing their grief. Well, guess what? The Bible says Jesus joined in with them. Jesus, say it with me, Jesus wept. I said, say it with me, Jesus wept. It's okay. It's okay to weep. It's okay to cry. One day Jesus was coming down the hill of the Mount of Olives. And he came to a certain spot and he stopped. And there he looked across the Kidron Valley, saw the city Jerusalem, said, "Oh, Jerusalem, oh, Jerusalem. How I would have gathered you in my arms as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you would not." He was weeping over the people. I'm just trying to say to you this morning, we need to be honest with our grieving. And if we need to weep, guess what? We need to weep. Because it's okay, I said it's okay, to grieve. Secondly, what do we do when our world comes crashing down? We just need to acknowledge that every blessing we have is a gift from God. Woo, church, every blessing we have today, it's a gift from God. Job, he acknowledged that everything he has was really a gift that was given to him by God himself. In verse 21, look what he says in verse 21. He says this, "The Lord gave." Wow. "The Lord gave. The Lord giveth." He says, "I came into this world naked." In other words, I came in here naked. And naked, I'm going to return. You're not going to take anything with you. Amen. You might be buried in a $500 suit or a $500 dress, but you will not take anything with you when you step out into eternity. Amen. I've preached a lot of funerals, and I've not seen a U-Haul behind a hearse yet. You're not going to take it with you when you go to glory. There are too many people today who think that every good thing in their life is because they've earned it. Too many people think, "Well, I have this and I have that and I have this and I have that," and they'll name all these things because I've worked hard to achieve what I've got. Let me tell you something this morning. Whatever it is that you have, it's because God allowed it. It's because of God's blessings upon your life. There are too many people in America today who thinks that society owes them something. Let me tell you something. And I say this in love and respect. That's what's ruining America today. People, too many people out there wanting things handed to them on a silver platter. But you know what the Bible teaches? The Bible clearly teaches us that every good thing in life is a gift from God the Father. Amen. Whew, I'm going to say something. When I feel it, when I sense the Spirit, listen to me. Too many people out there bad-mouthing because they're struggling, because they're, listen to me. More people today are struggling and having a hard time because God is not number one in their lives. Here's what the Bible says. The Bible says, "I was young and now I'm old. I've never seen the seed begging for bread. I've never seen God's people having to beg for something to eat. I've never seen God's people who are sold out to God have to sleep out." Woo! Where's God at in your life? Job says that everything I have was a gift from God. Write this passage down. James says in James 1:17 that every good and perfect gift is from above. It comes down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Yes, the world out there is changing, but God does not change. The story of Job is a story that happened over 4,000 years ago. And the very same God that Job had a personal relationship with is the same God that you and I can have a relationship with today. Same God, amen, church? Come on. He wants to give you the gift of eternal life this morning. You're sitting here and you're lost. I'm telling you, God wants to save you. Amen. He wants to give you a brand new life. Amen. So if you're here today, my prayer is you'll get saved. But then listen to this. If you're here this morning and you're truly a believer, Jesus Christ truly lives in your heart, don't be like the old hog that's down and grubbing at the foot of the oak tree and eating the acorns on the ground, but refuses to look up to see where his blessings come from. Too often we get so wrapped up in our things and we talk about my job or my home or my car or my children or my grandchildren or my this and my that, and we never stop to look up to be reminded of where those blessings came from in the first place. I'll tell you something, you got a roof over your head, it's because God allows you to have a home. If you got a car to drive in, it's because God's blessed you to be able to drive. Thank God you didn't have to walk to church today. If you got clothes on your back and shoes on your feet and food on your table and your children are healthy and your grandbabies are, listen, you've got a reason to look up today and say, God, I just want to thank you, and God, I want to praise you, and I don't want to ask for another thing. I just want to thank you and bless your name because of what I already have. Woo! We ought to be shouting in the house today. Trying to think of that old song. When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and you'll be surprised at what the Lord has done. Woo! I'm looking at some people today that's been blessed. Amen. Blessed. Amen. When I wake up in the morning till I lay my head at rest, we're blessed, we're blessed, we're blessed. We ought to honor and praise the King this morning because of his goodness. So what do we do when our world caves in? Thirdly, this one's going to hurt. And here's the pill that we don't usually want to swallow. We want to just leave this one in the jar. So what do we do when our world caves in? We just need to accept the fact that God may take something away without giving us a reason. We just need to accept that. God might take something away without giving us a reason. Now go back to verse 21. Job said, the Lord giveth. And then he comes right back and says what? The Lord has taken away. We were singing a song. We used to sing it a lot in one of the churches I pastor. We used to sing, he gives and takes away. He gives and takes away. That's all I remember. My heart has choose to say, Lord, blessed be the name. You give and take away. You remember that? I had a man come to me one Sunday. He scolded me. He says, I can't believe you allow that church to sing that song. God don't take nothing away from his children. Really? You've never read the scripture. The Lord giveth, and the Lord, the Bible says, verse 21, the Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Now, as we get further into the book of Job, we're going to find out where Job asks the question why quite often. And he asks it in a variety of different ways. But here's the thing. God never gave Job a reason for all that happened. Beginning in chapter 38. Now, I don't want you to go there. We'll get there sometime this year. But in chapter 38, God actually begins to speak to Job. But he never gives Job really a reason for why the things happened. As far as we know, God never let Job in on the conversation that took place in heaven between God and Satan. Job didn't know about that. But God did say something to Job to remind Job of his wisdom, of his greatness, and his power is beyond our ability to comprehend. We can't comprehend God. Amen? Now watch this. If you think that you deserve an answer to the question, why God did this happen, then your concept of God is too small. If you think, now I preached here several weeks ago, it's okay to ask why. It's okay. There's going to come a time when you need to cry out, God, why? God, what are you doing? But understand, God's not obligated to give you an answer. He's not. There will always be a sense of mystery. There's always going to be a sense of awe when it comes to the Father. Amen. In the book of Romans, Paul was writing about God's plan for the ages. And he breaks out in this observation in Romans 11:33. He said, oh, the depth and the riches of the wisdom, the knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Who has known the mind of the Lord or been his counselor? Or who has ever given to God that God should repay him? Now listen to me. I want you to listen very closely. When you've lost something, or when you have lost something precious, sometimes it's easy for us to forget that it's the Lord who takes away. Satan can't take away from you. Satan on his own will, Satan in his own power cannot take away from you. If something is taken away, if you lose, it's because God allowed it. Are you listening, church? I remember years ago, a pastor and his wife, good friends, wanted for years and years and years and years and years and years to have a child. Finally, they had a baby. The baby lived to be 3 years old and died of leukemia. And my pastor friend Mike, for the longest, he'd say, God, why did you take Laura? Weeks later, I'd see him again, and he'd still be weeping. God, why did you take Laura? God, you knew we wanted a child. God, why? After all these years of praying and waiting and hoping and pleading, God, why did you take Laura? Finally, one day he said, Pastor, he said, one day it just hit me. He said, it hit me, and I just began to think like this. You know what? Laura really didn't belong to me. Laura was just a gift from God. Laura belonged to the Lord. And in my selfishness, I wanted back what really belonged to God. He said, you know, when I realized that, I changed from saying, God, why did you take Laura, to saying, God, thank you for the 3 years that I had with her. Just thank you, Lord, for the 3 wonderful years of memories. We can't forget. There was a time when I wept and I cried when I lost my father. I couldn't understand that. But now I look back over it and I'm just saying, Lord, just thank you for the few years that I did have. Because in those few short years, boy, you taught me a lot. Amen. The Lord gives, and it's the Lord who takes away. Every good thing in this life, it comes from above. I said, church, every good thing in this life, it comes from above. So if my home and my car and if my finances and if my children and my grandbabies, if all those things belong to Him, I'm just the manager for right now. And if He gives them to me, He can take them, any of it, anytime that He chooses. Let me close. When our world caves in, here's going to be the fourth pill that's hard to swallow. But when our world caves in, we are to offer praise to God. And when you don't feel like it, faith it. Amen. Offer praise to God. And when you don't feel like it, faith it. Amen. Has anybody ever given you this advice? Cheer up. It could get worse. Anybody ever said that? Well, guess what? Job cheered up and things got worse. I said, Job cheered up, but things got worse. We'll see, starting next Sunday, how Satan began to intensify the attacks against Job. Wow. Instead of assessing blame, you know what Job did? Instead of trying to blame somebody, instead of trying to point a finger some direction, Job just began to express praise to God. And that's what it means in verse 21, where it says, Job said, blessed be the name of the Lord. What do you think Job really felt like doing? Well, his wife said, honey, won't you curse God and die? I have no doubt, hearing that he lost $46 million, and then on top of that, all 10 of his children were killed. I wonder how many times did maybe that thought flash through Job's mind. What's the use? I mean, we know how Miss Job felt. Mrs. Job let her feelings be known. But Job was a man that didn't live by his feelings. He's a man that lived by faith. Amen. So listen, when you're hurting, and there's some of you here today that are, and if it's not you, you might be hurting before the day's over with. You might be hurting before this week is over with. Listen to me. When you are hurting, you've got to make the choice by faith to praise God. I choose to praise the Lord. I choose to worship Him, even when my circumstances are pitiful. When everything around me is falling apart. Watch this, church. When my world is collapsing, when everything is falling apart, I still choose to praise the Lord. My circumstances is not always good. I've had issues lately. We're concerned about our 11-year-old grandson. I don't want nothing to happen. But I'm so thankful this morning that my circumstances don't determine my happiness. I'm glad my circumstances doesn't determine my joy. I've got something that the world didn't give, and the world can't take it away. I've got something this morning that when all of this starts falling down, when all of this starts caving in, when everything starts collapsing, I can still, like Job, hold my head up and say, I know my Redeemer lives. Wow. Wow. God taught me something. I think it was Friday. I walked in the office Friday, and there's been work going on, and there's been construction and different things, and everything in the office was that thick in dust and just in disarray. And I got the staff together, and I said, we're fixing to have a spring cleaning. And I want everybody to go to work. And Jason, I put you in charge. And before we leave here today, I want this to be a clean, brand new office. And I said, now get to work. Boy, I went to cleaning. I started throwing things away that I've been holding on to for 40 years. I kid you not. I had three, four, Jordan saw it. I started throwing things away in my office. I filled up bags. I was cleaning. I come across a can of air freshener that I didn't know I had. I had a can of air freshener down in my desk drawer. I pulled it out and I went to spray it, and it didn't work. Been in the drawer that long. I picked it up, and here's what I saw. It just jumped out at me. It said, warning, contents under pressure. Keep away from open flame. Can could explode if heat is applied. And I'm standing and I'm reading that aerosol can and I'm thinking, wow. Wow. That's like a lot of members of Milldale. I'm looking at it, and I said, wow, there's Milldale. And I looked at it real close, and I went, oh, there's me. We're under so much pressure. We're under so much stress, sickness. Look what Tony's going through. Think about what Miss Oshie's had to go through all these years. She was in Sunday school today. What's Miss Sheila faced with now? What What's Miss Deanna got still faced with right now? What are you faced with? Brother Ed. Miss Betty, what are you faced with? Some of us right now, if something doesn't change quickly, boom! It's amazing to see those of us who call ourselves believers, what comes out when we're faced with the pressures of life. Because I know one thing for certain, what's in here will sooner or later come out. It did for Job, and it will with you. I wonder this morning, our God is a God that can make something good come out of chaos. I know beyond a shadow of a doubt this morning that our God is the kind of God that he can get good to come out of something bad. I was talking to an elderly couple the other day, and they were still saying, we lost our homes, our home, we lost our cars, plural. She said, we lost everything, all of our personal belongings, all of our pictures, things we've been holding on to. She said, it's all gone. And she was weeping. And this was just the other day. She stood there and she wept. And then she said this. But praise God, I still have my life, and I have my husband, and I still have my children, and I got my grandbabies, and I have great-grandbabies. And she was looking up the whole time she said it. And then she turned and she said, Brother Dennis, I'm a blessed woman. You know what? She was right. And whatever you're going through today, when your world caves in, there's one thing I'm going to caution you not to do. Don't blame God. Don't blame God. Chapter 1, verse 22 says, in all of this, Job did not sin by charging God with wrongdoing. Boy, when your world caves in, it's easy. Watch this. Satan wants us to start pointing fingers and blame this and that and blame this person and blame that person. No, my friend, be like Job. Job suffered a lot, but through it all, his faith remained strong. It was 1492 when Columbus sailed the Atlantic Ocean. And did you know that the common belief in those days out of Europe was that if you sailed too far west, you'd fall off the edge of the world, and you'd be no more. Well, in England, there was a nautical map that dated back to King Henry IV. And the map makers wrote this across the map on the Atlantic Ocean, and it said this. Here be dragons, here be demons, here be danger. And based upon that superstition, men were afraid to sail across the Atlantic Ocean. Well, there just happened to be a believer by the name of John Franklin who'd studied the Word of God. He studied God's Word, and he knew that the Bible said that God sits above the circle of the earth. So John Franklin took a pen, and he marked out, here be dragons, here be demons, here be danger, and he wrote these words, here be God. Here be God. Church, your world may be caving in, crumbling down around you. You might be in the midst of the storm this morning. But God would have me to remind us all, even in the midst of the storm, here be God. He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. The storm's going to pass. And after the storm passes, God will still be there. And everybody said, I know my Redeemer lives. Yes, I know my Redeemer lives. Do you know that this morning? Let's pray. If you're a servant of God today, I said, if you're a servant of God this morning, you need to know that as you sail into your darkest fears, as you sail through your deepest worries today, know that God is there. Know this morning, He's there to keep you. He's there to sustain you. And be like Job. When he got the worst news that a person could possibly receive, he looked up and said, I know my Redeemer lives. If you're here today and you've never given your life to Christ, would you come in this invitation? Brother Sean and I are here. If you're here today and you know this is the church home, you need to come and join. Would you step out and come and just say, I want to be a part of what God is doing here at Milldale. There's people all over this house today that need prayer. So I'm going to ask you to do this. Now listen closely. This is not for show. This is because the Holy Spirit is here, and I believe the Holy Spirit is wanting to do something. But if you're here right now and you're in a storm and you need God to do something in your life and you want somebody to pray with you, I want you to come get in this altar right now because we're going to gather around you. Maybe you need to come today and just get here in behalf of somebody. But you're needing God to do something in the midst of the storm. So if you'll come get in this altar, we'll surround you. People will come pray with you. You say, we've already prayed. Don't matter. Come on. Don't matter. Just come on. Would you be obedient? Come on. Father, this is your chance. This is an opportunity, Lord, for you to minister to people. Now let your will be done. I pray for obedience. Obedience. In Jesus' name. Would you stand with me? Our heads are bowed. Brother Kirk's going to sing. Who'll be the first to step out? Somebody need to come on right now. Just slip out. Come right now. Come quickly. Come on quickly.
Jesus, I surrender.
You bow your heads. It's time to worship of the Lord and giving back His tithes, our offerings. I pray this morning that you'll be obedient, that you would give accordingly so that God's work can be carried out here at Milldale. Father, would you now bless these gifts, these tithes, our offerings. You've blessed us, Lord, and you've blessed us beyond measure, and we're so grateful, so thankful. Now bless the gift and the giver. May you be honored and glorified in this part of our worship. In Jesus' name, Amen. Amen.
Come to worship today with us here at Milldale, and take your bulletin home with you. It's just full.